Hey guys, what's going on? Paul here. Welcome back to another Cardano video. So overall, a good week for Cardano. One of the better ones we've had in a while with the bullish news I mentioned in the video earlier in the week about the Grayscale fund, the different bridges that are building and upcoming releases. Milkameda have since said they will launch on Monday on mainnet. The price has broken out of the long-term downtrend as well. Things could have been a lot worse though if it wasn't for the Wingriders team finding the vulnerabilities in the Minswap code. We could have been looking at headlines talking about a Cardano DEX hacked for over $100 million. Thankfully, no user funds were lost. In this video, I'll get into the details on what happened there and some of the lessons that can be learned for both the development side and for the community as well. And this should really highlight some of the risks that I talked about when I done my early video on yield farming, talking about the risks and rewards. If you think others can benefit, please do share it out. Questions, comment them down below, or even just leave one for the algorithm. Give it a like and let's jump into it. Okay, so just a quick bit of a background before we get into this. Minswap are a DEX building on top of Cardano. If you follow the channel here, you'll know I've covered them in a few videos talking about their LBE and the DEX and how to do yield farming on the DEX as well. But they became the number one DEX on Cardano by TVL, which is Total Value Locked, I think less than a week ago. So they are currently sitting at $195 million locked on the exchange. And even before they shut down for 2 days, we will talk about that as well, they were over $200 million in TVL, which is a lot of money. So what happened here was they open sourced their contracts during the week, which is a great step for projects to do, to open source. It can help give the community other ideas on what they can build. And it does let people look at your code and pick out if there are any potential issues. And that is what has happened here. The Wingriders team, which are building a DEX themselves, I actually have an interview with them on Monday. That was all set up before this all came to light. So I can ask some questions during that call on Monday if you have them, so leave them down below. But they found some vulnerabilities in the Minswap code. They reported them to the team. One of the vulnerabilities was a critical one that would have left it that any hacker would have been able to drain every single cent out of the smart contracts. They could have stolen everything that was on the Minswap DEX. So we'll get into that in a minute. I won't get into the technical details on it. I'll show you where you can find it all though. So Minswap have, there's three articles I will link down below. Minswap's article here talks about the vulnerability and everything from their perspective. Wingriders have put one out as well, talking about how they found the bugs and given more of a technical, bit more technical detail on what they are. And also the Minswap code was audited before it went live. It was done by Tweag and they have come out with a response to this as well. And basically saying, they missed it. They missed this bug. And thankfully, it's been found by someone, by an ethical team, rather than being found by a hacker. So if we look at, we'll start with the Minswap one here. And then at the end, I'm going to talk about some of the lessons learned and everything like that. And hopefully teams, both teams can look at this and the community can look at this and lots of people can learn from this. Because look, this was a lucky escape for the Cardano community as well, because if, unfortunately, there is a thing out there that people think that if something is built on Cardano, Cardano is extremely safe. It is one of the most secure out there. But just because something is built on Cardano, it doesn't mean that automatically the dApps that are built are going to be 100% secure as well, because every project writes their own smart contracts, writes their own code. So when you're building code or building smart contracts, there can always be issues in them. And projects are in the early stages right now. So even like the audit company that missed this particular bug, audit companies are learning as well. So when you put something into a smart contract, when you get into DeFi, putting your funds into liquidity pools, putting them into yield farming or anything like that, not just on Minswap, on any of the DEXs or platforms launching, there is always that risk that you could lose everything you put in. So when you put your funds into something like this, I talked about this in the yield farming video I done, talking about the risks and rewards. So when you put them in, you give up custody of your funds. So that means you're trusting the contract that you're putting them into. In this case, unfortunately, there was an issue here, but then luckily it was found by a team that were able to report it and get it fixed before user funds were compromised. But that is the risk everyone takes. So when you're doing this, one thing I noticed from sitting back and watching this was that a lot of people were very over leveraged in what they put into smart contract or put into the contracts here. Some people talking about they had 50% of their portfolio, some having 100% of their portfolio put into something like this. For me personally, I would never even dream of getting close to them kind of percentages to put into something like this. For me, it's all the smaller percentages that go into this because I know the risks, I know what's possible. Yes, there are some substantial rewards when you look at the yield farming percentages, 200-300% APRs, but they do come with risks. So again, always provision your portfolio, whatever you put it in knowing the risks as well. So looking at this, what actually happened? So they said about the critical vulnerability that was found that could have drained the funds. What they done was because they have a centralized element to how they run the batching system. So like SundaeSwap, they use a batching system as well. But with Minswap, currently they run that system themselves. Now look, long term, they are going to decentralize that and let the community run this. So it's not something I'm worried about now. And in this case, it actually meant that they were able to basically shut down the DEX by stopping the orders going through when this issue was discovered. So another big issue that came out of this was that what they'd done was they moved all of the liquidity from the smart contract that had the vulnerability and moved it into a new smart contract that patched up the vulnerability and made sure that the funds couldn't be drained, well, couldn't be drained by this issue anyway. And it caused a lot of questions as well that why were the team able to access all of the funds and move them wherever they want, because generally when you put in funds, the funds should not be able to be moved by one central entity. It should only be able to go back to the person that provided the liquidity and not be able to be moved like that. So what turned around was that it says here, so in a bizarre but fortunate turn of events, the vulnerability and exploiting it made it possible to migrate the funds into the new upgraded contract. So the vulnerability that was discovered is what made them be able to move the funds from one contract to another. Now they do say down here that, so in an effort, can't see where it is exactly, but basically the new contract, they can't do that because they've patched up the vulnerability that was there and now you can't move funds from the new contract. So with the new one, they don't have that ability, which, as I say, no team should have it. It's not Minswap, not talking about Minswap specifically, but any project or any protocol out there shouldn't have that ability. So they said there was also some other less severe vulnerabilities than the batching system, which they have fixed up as well. Another knock-on on this as well is they have made that new pool creation is now permissioned. So they've put this centralized for now in that when you want to create a new pool on the Minswap DEX, it has to be done through a centralized process. I haven't seen the process for this yet to request how to do it or anything like that. But again, I'll share that out if I see it at some stage. And what they've said here as well is that they are immediately entering into a continuous audit and code review process with a new top Haskell firm. They haven't released what that is yet. And the change to the code that was implemented, they said that change to the contracts was small and doesn't have any known dependencies on it, but definitely going into another audit and getting people to check over the full code again is vital in a case like this. They say in the coming weeks, they will post an in-depth additional article talking about the vulnerabilities and what they've done to fix them up. So lots of lessons can be learned here, I think, from other projects looking at it, obviously directly the issue. And the Wingriders article goes more in detail on what the actual vulnerability was for people that want to check it out. And the same with the Tweag one here, just to touch on what the Wingriders one was. So this is all from their perspective about how they discovered it, got onto the team. One part here, they said for a moment they did consider exploiting the vulnerability themselves and returning the funds to the users that had put in the liquidity. I am glad they didn't do this and they were able to get in contact with the team, because essentially this would have been a full exploit or hack of the Minswap contracts. So I'm glad that didn't happen and it was the Minswap team that were able to bring in the fix for this. The vulnerability, so they talk about it here and how it all worked. So it comes down to how new pools are created within the DEX and who gets ownership of the pools. It's done by an NFT process, and there was essentially a bug within the minting policy where you could create a copy of the NFT that had control of the liquidity pool and use that in a new pool to take control of the funds. But again, the more technical details are all there for anyone who wants to get into it. They go into the code and everything like that. So they do say as well that they did expect the Minswap team to go into a full audit and that before going live again, but the Minswap team feel comfortable in the fixes that they've put out there. They say about there was some other issues in it, but they haven't gone into, or potential vulnerabilities, they haven't gone into it here because just in case they haven't been fixed up yet and they want to give the Minswap team time to make sure everything is fixed up before they talk about what they are. But again, in time, it would be great to see what them vulnerabilities are for other teams. Not to say that these were issues they found, but just for other teams that are building, to make sure that everybody learns from this and learns from the issues that are here to patch any potential vulnerabilities in that area going forward. As I said, look, you're never going to get every single issue. Thankfully, the major vulnerability here that could have drained the liquidity pool completely was found by an ethical team. So huge thanks to Wingriders. I had funds in there myself, so I'm very thankful that the funds weren't stolen. When you look at Tweag here as well, so their response to it was that when they were notified of the issue, everyone here on the audit team was dismayed since we had conducted the audit on Minswap for not long before. They had found three critical issues that would have likewise enabled an attacker to empty the reserves when they'd done the audit, and 13 issues in total. They were all fixed up before Minswap went live. So Minswap done things right. They did get their audit. They obviously missed the bug themselves, but they done their audit and the audit company missed the bug too. So nothing is ever 100%. What I would say from this situation is, look, like I said, when Sunday Swap went live and people were giving out about different issues and focusing on the negatives, there's always positives to be there. So look at what went right here. Look at the issues that were found. Look at how an ethical team was able to find the code. Look at what went right. See, can you implement that in your own development? So this is from a project perspective, and take the good out of this, as well as the issues that were here or the potential disaster this could have been. Take all of that, learn from it, and use it in your own development. I would say, just on the communication side, obviously it's very easy to look back in hindsight and say this should have been done and that should have been done. I'd say it was absolutely panic stations, everything going crazy within the Minswap team when this was announced. I would say from other projects as well, look at that as well and analyze how the community reacted and how things were going on. I would say there could have been more official confirmation or announcements from the team, maybe every few hours. If you set it, if something happens to your project and everything is going to shit at the time, obviously everything turned out okay here, but set it that every 4 hours you will get an official update from the team of what's going on. I know there was some people sitting, the coders, the team were obviously working crazy hours trying to get this fixed, but there was also a lot of the community were sitting just pressing refresh on the decks, worried about their funds, worried about trying to get in first to see what was happening. So I would say give announcements and say, look, there's nothing going to happen for the next 6 hours. We will give an update after 6 hours. So do that. And then every 6 hours or 5 hours or whatever you want to do, just give the official updates. So everything is structured and everybody knows what's happening. And basically funds are safe when things like this are going on. Hopefully we don't see these things again. But look, unfortunately, I think it's part of DeFi. You're going to see issues like this. Obviously, an outcome like this is very good. We look across other protocols and we see these huge hacks that have happened. And sometimes people get a bit carried away saying Cardano has never had a hack or it's never had smart contract breach or anything like that. There will come a day when there will be a smart contract breach on Cardano and it won't be an ethical party that finds it. So be prepared for that. Have the allocation of your own portfolio set that if something like that happens with funds you've put in, that it will not be a complete disaster for you, that you haven't put something like life savings or anything like that into this. Not specifically Minswap, I'm talking about all of the different protocols that are launching out there. Issues can happen, just be prepared for them and make it that if something happens with one that you have funds in, it's not going to completely crush you. So I hope this has helped, a bit of a rant on all of the different issues, but look, turned out okay this time, and hopefully a lot more people can be prepared going forward as well. As I record this, the Minswap DEX is back up and running fine. Everything seems to be working well. In terms of price, I would say it's holding up fairly well because they have built a very solid community there, because the team behind this have always been focused on the community. So they have built up a very loyal community there. So things seem to be holding out fairly well at the minute. And it will be interesting to see how things go over the next while as well. Thanks for watching, guys. I will talk to you soon.